rock's wombs, and he provides water from a rock, and he provides manna from heaven, and he brought down the walls of Jericho. He froze the sun, allowing victory. He's toppled giants with tiny stones. He's brought fire from heaven. He's shut the mouths of lions. He preserved life in the belly of a well. He's fed thousands with a few loaves. He gives the weak strength. He heals the sick. He's made the blind see, the deaf hear, the mute speak, the lame walk, and he's overcome evil, and he's made a way through death for you and me by the death and the resurrection of his son, Jesus Christ, that we will live with him forever. We will dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever and ever and ever. What are we afraid of? His resume is flawless. He controls everything. And he loves you.
Dang. That. That'll get your blood moving. I want to invite you guys, please stand with us. We're going to worship in that frame of mind, in that heart that says, you have done it all, and we're just responding at this point.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I met you. I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my tomb till I met you. You called my name and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness into your glorious day. You called my name and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness into your glorious day. My name.
that was nice. It's a beautiful story that we sing about. It's a beautiful Savior we worship. I invite you guys to find a beautiful family around you. There's some Christians, some believers who want to share some love. Pass it around, everybody you can meet, all right? Tell them, good morning. It's a glorious day.
I'll charge the other one. Yeah, and then this plug doesn't work on that one. Unless you have a charger by yours. My head, it died.
I gave her that one.
Where's
this one? It doesn't, it's a different one.
Oh, it's a different one.
Yeah, but it's okay.
There is, I got the other tablet.
Good morning.
I'm wired. Yeah.
Okay, I'll take it off.
Okay, charge it back. Back. Thanks.
Don't. I guess I could just. See.
I can't even hear it.
Huh? Turned it on. That'd be a good ambiance. Yeah, thank you. It was funny.
All right, we'll invite you guys. Y'all go ahead and have a seat. But you're still allowed to love. We're not going to hit the brakes on that. But we got a really cool moment to share with you guys this morning. So we're transitioning that group up now.
God, we're standing on this mountaintop.
It has been a long climb.
Behind us are the things we thought were so important.
12 years of first days of school.
Summer vacations.
School dances and homecomings.
Lunchroom food and locker rooms.
Recesses and study halls.
Grade after grade of report cards and parent-teacher conferences.
Teachers and tutors and coaches. Science fairs and assemblies.
Those 12 years behind us. Down there at the bottom of this mountain.
Now, Lord, we have climbed to the top.
And we wait in the dark to see what happens next.
There on the horizon, we know the moment. The light pierces the darkness.
The glow, the rays of light and warmth.
Radiating, illuminating, that is our future. We have climbed this high to see it.
All those things we learned are the threads we have used to build these wings.
We are not stepping off into an abyss, God.
This is flight. This is soaring. We have come this far to launch.
To ascend.
To aspire.
Now we hope in you, Lord.
Don't let us grow tired.
Renew our strength through you, and we'll soar on wings like eagles.
We are prepared to fly into our future.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Jackson, and this is my wife, Amanda. And thank you. And for those of you that don't know us, for almost 2 years now, we've been the youth leaders here at the church. Over those 2 years, we've gotten to know some really awesome kids, and today we want to honor the graduating class of 2022. So we're going to call you guys up one by one, and we will say a little bit about you, and we have a little gift from the church as well.
So I just want to add that it's been an honor and a blessing to be able to be with you guys, to be able to serve the church in this way, but also serve you guys in this way. We love you guys. So we'll go ahead and start with Melody Barker. Melody has been homeschooled since eighth grade and has been dual enrolled at Polk State for the past 3 years. Melody is an avid artist and plans to pursue a career in freelance artwork. She also has interest in psychology and music.
Just Next, we have Jackson Gerard.
Jackson!
Jackson is graduating from Candlelight Christian Academy. He plans to attend Polk State College and transfer to Jacksonville University to pursue a Bachelor of Science degree in Aviation Management and Flight Operations. Jackson was awarded the James C. Ray Scholarship last December, which funds high school students while they are training to get their private pilot's license. He will have that later this year. Jackson is also a world champion barefoot water skier and holds national and world records in the sport. He has traveled across the nation to Canada and to Italy, representing the USA in ski competitions. He retired from skiing in 2019 and now competes on the Young Guns team in sporting clay tournaments. He hopes to continue competing on the college level and is working part-time giving lessons. Jackson hopes to become a commercial pilot in the future and work for a company like FedEx.
Next, we have Mandy Lugo Noble. Mandy is graduating from Lake Wells High School, where she was involved in both the executive board and dance company for all 4 years. And Mandy will be spending her summer working as an Omega at Lake Aurora Christian Camp. In the fall, she plans to pursue cosmetology at Summit Salon Academy.
And next we have Tommy H.C. Wofford IV. Tommy is 18 years old and is a homeschool graduate through an affiliation with Black Homeschoolers of Central Florida. Tommy serves as a member of Citizens Support Service of Lake Wales. His involvement in musical theater has been a large part of his middle and high school years. He is a part of Theater Winter Haven's Drama Time Live traveling theater troupe. Tommy enjoys songwriting and aspires to be a playwright. He is this year's recipient of the Lake Wales Rotary Club's Musical Scholarship and has been He has also been accepted into the Theater Gap Initiative program, which he will attend in August of 2022 in Charlotte, North Carolina. Here are our graduates.
Yes, stand up for him. Let him hear it. Woo! I'm so excited for these graduates. You know, it's so cool because some of them I've seen grow. And today we're going to have a special prayer for them. I'm going to ask you guys just to come in and hover a little bit, okay? Hover. Yes. Come on, Tommy. I know you hover. All right. Because I want to be able to move around a little bit. Please join me, and we're going to lay our hands on them, and we're going to say a special prayer for these guys as they get ready to go. Guys, I want to say one thing. This part of the journey is over, but it's not over. Mm-hmm. It's just changing. And you guys get ready, because you are some of the best of the best. Mm-hmm. Except you have to work on you. No, I'm only kidding. Let's pray. Father God, what an honor to call these kids our kids. And Father, that we have had just a little bit of being able to pour into their lives. Father, we thank you for their families. We thank you for their friends, their colleagues, the ones that they have learned from, their teachers. Father, their travels, their coaches. And Lord, everyone has had a part in forming them and molding them. But Lord, you have put the life into them. These guys are outstanding in their fields. And Lord, you have gifted them beyond gifting. And so we just pray that they will not forget their dreams. That, Father, their dreams now become a reality. And they can take flight. They can make a difference in this world. And, Father, we can look back and we can say, come on, we got your back. We will never let them be alone. So, Father, help us to continue to pray for them. Help us to continue to lift them up. And help them, Father, to keep their eyes on you. Because now's the hard part. As they strike out what they think is on their own, but really, you're right behind them. So, Father, I just pray that they will feel your hand on their shoulder. I pray, God, that you will be with them, keep them safe, and, Father, let them follow their dreams. So, graduates, as much as we love you, it's time to let you fly. We thank you for all that you mean to us and that we continue. We thank you that you're part of our church. And Father, we thank you for letting them know how much you love them. We love you, God. And they all said, amen. Amen. Give them another hand, please.
All right. Y'all good. Y'all good.
It just kind of, you know, gives you a little tear every once in a while. If you don't know me, I'm Pastor Ann, and I'm the kids' pastor here, and excited.
You cry sometimes.
What did you say?
You cry sometimes.
I do cry sometimes. I do cry a lot. And I just want to look around because I haven't been in here in so long because I'm back with your kids. And it's so good to see all of you here. And this morning, I just want to share a few announcements of things that are coming up because not only are the graduates' lives changing, but so are ours. School will be out in a week. Hallelujah, praise God. And so we've got just a few announcements that we want to talk about today really quick. Community Kitchen is right after service. And if you would like to help serve our community, what an opportunity it is for you and your family. Take your kids. Let them learn from you. And it's downtown on Crystal Avenue. There's a picture of the building on the screen. And go down and help serve a meal. Show our community how much we care. This is the best church in this community. And so we want to show God's love pouring out through us to them. So if you can be there, go right after church. It starts immediately, right? Like at noon or something, right? All right, so let's get out there. People have been asking me what's going on next week. Big time church picnic. If you've never joined the church picnic, you don't want to miss this one. This is the all family church picnic. That means everyone is invited, and we have it out at Lake Aurora. In other words, we take over Lake Aurora before camp starts. The swimming area is going to be open. Carpet ball. Do you know what carpet ball is? I played for the first time. Okay. Don't make fun of me, Steve. Hey, no. No. All right. But the carpet ball is there. We picnic, we eat. There's going to be a huge kickball game afterwards for everybody. You can come at different times. But I want to tell you something that's going to happen at the beginning. At like 3 o'clock, you want to come out and watch. Mr. Bill Redmond's from Stirring Water is bringing out the huge canoes, the big canoes. See it? 10 people can get in it. And our children are answering the Lord's command to help the world. And they are raising money by doing a paddle-a-thon is what I call it. It's a paddle challenge to where for every stroke they take, you know, like a walk-a-thon or rock-a-thon, for every stroke they're raising money for one of our missionaries in India. And we're going to buy a scooter for him so that he can go to the churches. He's in charge of 6 churches and can only get to 2. So we're buying a scooter for him. And the kids want to raise money. And so them and their... Yeah, I know. It's awesome. And so they and their adult, which could be you, it's moms, dads, any friends, anybody that wants to be their partner in the canoe can help raise money by paddling across the lake and back. That starts at 3. And then at 3:30, the swimming area opens. And then at like 4:30 or 5, the food starts. So if you can't come for the whole thing, come for whatever part you can. It is a great day. We have a lot of fun. And if you want to come out and help support our young ones, we need your help to do that. And so come out and watch them. They're excited about getting in the giant canoe. I'm excited about getting in the giant canoe. So come on out. Turn me off. Really? Don't forget, I can talk a lot louder than this mic, Leslie. All right. The last thing I want to ask, and then I've got things I need to do in the back. But we are at the end of our school year, and several of our team members are going to be gone in our kids' area. We have the most incredible volunteer team who watches and pours into your Amen. Kids. And they are always needed, but we need some more help. We've got some babies. We even have one of our team members who feels like she needs time off to have a baby. And she's going to have a baby next month. So we have another baby coming. Bobby just had a new baby. We are in need of people to rock our babies and play with our babies and up to our four-year-olds especially. Just come and play. Some people are saying, you know, you're just done for the teaching year is over. You've got some free time now. Come and just sit and rock a baby. What a difference from the kids that's in your classroom. Well, maybe not much of a difference. But anyway, help is needed in the back. We need some time. Some of our workers need some time to breathe. And so if you want to help, I'm going to be at our sign-in desk right after service. Please come see me. I'll tell you all about it. You can tell me what you'd like to do. I had somebody come up, hey, add me. I'll do too. If you want to just serve for the summer, that's awesome. Be part of our summer team. You get a cool t-shirt too. So anyway, I need to go. But it's a pleasure seeing you. We're glad you're at our church today if you're new. And I hope that you feel welcome. Mm-hmm. I hope, and I'll tell you who to stay away from. Just come and see me, okay? Some of these pastors we have to worry about. Okay, start the music. I'm out. All right, have a great day.
All right, you guys, go ahead and stand up with us.
Set your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray. Unveil why we were made. Set our hearts ablaze with hope, like wildfire in our very soul. Holy Spirit, come and invade us. We need your power in us.
second. I know that there's a decent chance that there's several of us in the room who feel like the waves are overwhelming us, that we're not going to make it. I don't know how many times I've said that phrase in my life, God, I can't do this, I can't make it. And I do thank you so much, and I believe with all sincerity, every one of us who come to that point are where we need to be in relation to you. God, I know that it's tempting to think on autopilot or in my control. I can manage everything in the world. I can manage my family, my job, and all of that, and that's just not reality. Today, may we be a group of people who are aware of this, who are excited at the proposition that I'm going to put this down finally. I'm going to hand it to the Creator who designed everything in the world. I'm going to hand my life. I'm going to hand my heart. God, help us all to hand our families, our futures, into your hands. Jesus, you have been so amazing, and we say thank you. We say thank you for your son, obviously, for the sacrifice. We say thank you for the freedom and the life that we're able to appreciate and walk in now. God, we thank you for the future and the hope that's in front of us. We say thank you in the name of Jesus, because it's by his name that every stripe is healed. It's by his name alone that every knee will bow and every tongue will confess. And it's in that name that we pray, and God's people sing, God's people pray, God's people say all together now, amen. Please have a seat.
Good morning. Graduation Sunday. Cool. You know, maybe we need Robert back up here with his cap and gown to do communion meditation again. That was pretty cool. High school graduation. How many people remember that? Yeah. I hate to say, but last year was my 40th high school reunion. I didn't go. I was in Cincinnati, but that's not the only reason I didn't go. You know, I did see pictures of it on Facebook, and I recognized the names, but I didn't recognize any of the faces. And I don't know what's up with that. I don't think I've changed any at all. But remembering things. You know, I make lists to help me remember things. You know, I make lists of long-term projects, short-term projects. I make lists of what I need to accomplish during a workday. I even have a list of what I need to buy, just if I happen by Rural King or Lowe's. But I use that to keep things in front of me, to help me remember things. And I kind of use that during communion time, my personal communion time, kind of a bullet point. You know, first I try to look back. Back to the cross, I try to remind myself his sacrifice, his unselfish, completely to atone for my sins. And he did this while we were still sinners. We read in Romans 5:8, but God demonstrates his own love for us in this: while we are still sinners, Christ died for us. We didn't do anything to start that process. He did it all. Secondly, I look to the present, here and now. How do I see myself? What have I done this week? Am I striving daily for holiness? Did I put Jesus first in my life, or is he a distant second or third? You know, God wants us to acknowledge our shortcomings and humbly ask for forgiveness. Third, I look to the future. Am I looking forward to the time when I'll have communion with him in his kingdom? In Matthew 26, he says, I tell you, I will not drink of the fruit of this vine until the day when I drink it anew with you in my Father's kingdom. Are we looking forward to that time with hope or with fear? If you knew the Lord was coming tomorrow, it's a good question, what would you do differently today? Hopefully that answer would be like what John said. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. Because he wrote in Revelations, he who testifies to these things says, yes, I'm coming soon. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. Let us pray. Father God, please help us concentrate on you, your son's death, his resurrection, and our future with you in eternity. Father, remove all the distractions, things and thoughts that don't belong here right now. Just help us resolve that this next week we'll do a little better job than we did this previous week. We pray and we love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hey guys, how we doing? Hey, if we've never met before, my name is Steve. I'm the pastor here at Church on the Move, and we are just excited to have you with us today. Today we're going to be in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 8. If you guys have a Bible, go ahead and turn there with me. We got a lot of ground to cover, but as you do, I want to tell you guys about the penguins of Phillip Island, Australia. Now, if you've never seen these are pretty amazing penguins. On the shores of Phillip Island, there are burrows of thousands upon thousands of penguins. And these guys are the smallest penguins in the world. They're about 30 centimeters tall, just really cute little birds that go out to sea every day. The adults will go out into the ocean, they'll go fishing, and at the end of the day, they'll come back and bring what they've got to the chicks in the burrows. Now, what's crazy, though, is this has become kind of like a tourist phenomenon. Like, they've set up bleachers in this place on Phillip Island so that you can watch the penguins come back to shore. Apparently, it's a funny, exhilarating show and as these penguins come waddling back across the shore. And what will end up happening is at the end of day, these groups of penguins just start showing up on the seashore. And this large group of penguins, and at some point, one of the groups just starts tearing off across the beach. All right, the burrow's about 100 meters away, and there's a lot of open sand in between. And as they get 10 to 20 feet, as they're like kind of waddling out there as penguins just racing across the beach, they'll turn quickly, and then they'll dart back to the ocean. And then another group will tear off across the beach to try and get to the burrows, and about 50 meters, they'll turn back. And they'll do this thing back and forth until the sun goes down, these groups of penguins trying to get to their burrows. And it's kind of crazy to watch people kind of just laugh at them tripping over themselves and all this stuff as they're waddling out of the seashore. And what's happening is this back and forth motion is the penguins are afraid. Like they're terrified. See, in the ocean, they're quick. They're fast. They can move. They can avoid predators. They can dive down deep. In the burrows, they're safe because they're underground. But in that 100-meter open stretch, they are terrified to race across the beach because out of the corner of their eye, they might see a shadow or they might see something moving. And as soon as they see that, the entire group races back to safety. It's comical to watch, but it's really not too different from us. Like, how often do we race back to safety in our lives the second we see some hint of danger, some moment where we just don't know what's going to happen next? You know, we sing songs about going out into the wonders of the deep on the oceans, but let's be honest, sometimes we get really terrified of that idea, stepping out into the wild, great unknown. Guys, what are you afraid of today? What's got you afraid in your faith, in your heart, in your life, in your circumstances? Like we all have fears. Like, some of you guys are afraid of the dark. Just own it, you know? Doesn't matter. You're afraid of the dark. Or you're afraid of heights. Like, standing up here on the stage might be terrifying for you. You're afraid of crowds, being up in front of people. You're afraid. Some of you guys, you've got those, you know, those fears that just don't make sense. Like, you'll go into your bathroom and you'll check behind the shower curtain before. I know it's not just me. You guys do that. All right? Or you'll go out to your car late at night, and what do? You open the back door before you open the front door just to make sure. You got to check. And, you know, you want to be safe. What are you afraid of today? What are you afraid of? Today we're going to look at a couple stories in Luke's gospel where fear is dripping off the page. And I want us to learn to channel that fear into a greater faith. And so we're tracking through the gospel of Luke this year as a church. Luke chapter 8, we're going to pick it up in verse 22. It says, one day Jesus said to his disciples, let's go over to the other side of the lake. And so they got into a boat, they set out. And as they sailed, he fell asleep. And a squall came down on the lake so that the boat was being swamped and they were in great danger. Disciples went and woke him, saying, Master, Master, we're going to drown. And he got up and he rebuked the wind and the raging waters. The storm subsided and all was calm. Where is your faith? He asked his disciples. In fear and amazement, they asked one another, who is this? He commands even the winds and the waters, and they obey him. Okay, so one day, they go out onto the lake. Jesus says, hey, let's go to the other side of the Sea of Galilee. And there's this incredible storm that comes upon them. The wind is raging. The waves are crashing down all around them. And the disciples, man, these are seasoned fishermen. These are manly men, but they're terrified of what's happening in this moment. They're terrified of the storm. They're going out of their minds. They're fearing for their very lives as the waves crash down all around them. But Jesus, somehow he's able to sleep. He's able to be just below deck. He's nowhere to be found, taking a little nap. And disciples run down, teacher, master, don't you care about us? Don't you care what's happening right now in our world? Don't you care if we drown? Don't you care about the wind and the waves? Master, don't you care? Guys, do we ever feel that way? Like the chaos is all around you? And like any moment you're going to be swept away by the raging waters and of your schedule, your to-do list, all the emotional baggage that just keeps piling up in your life, and you're exhausted, and spiritually you feel dried up in your life, and with each new day it just feels like a little more chaos is just creeping in around you. The water's flooding into the boat and you feel like you're sinking and you're crying out, don't you care about me? And I love what Jesus does. Like, he doesn't get up and grab a bucket and start bailing out water like, oh, let's get to work. And he doesn't, like, panic. He doesn't say, hey, guys, we need to really rally around here. We need to have a prayer circle in the middle of the boat right now. No. He walks past their panic. He walks past their fear. He walks right past their trembling and all the cries the disciples have. And he stares out into the chaos. He stares out into the raging seas. He rebukes the wind. He rebukes the waves. He says, peace, be still. And everything becomes calm. Everything just kind of settles down. Guys, I need that reminder in my life. Some days I need to remember. Some days I need that in my life because things just get so crazy. And I know I'm not the only one where it feels hectic and the madness and all this is just around me. And I need the reminder that Jesus is still in control of the storm. That see, he's still sovereign over these areas. That he has power to step into my madness and speak words of life and somehow bring order to my chaos that I keep creating for myself. That he can bring life into any moment that we face. That he can step into our life and make a difference. Peace. Be still. Where do you need to hear that in your heart today? Because we're going to find out that Jesus has the power to overcome any circumstance that we find ourselves in. And so guys, the disciples, they're amazed. And they're afraid. Like they're amazed and afraid. It's all built into one. Like they've never seen anything like this. Like who is this man that can look at the wind and the waves and tell them to stop and they stop? He controls the sea. He has supernatural authority over chaos itself. That statement probably needs a little more explanation. See, the ancient peoples of Canaan and later Israel, they had a very supernatural worldview. In fact, we're going to be talking about that this summer if you want to check it out on Wednesday nights. But these guys, they understood that running in tandem to our physical existence, it was a spiritual realm that kind of commingled with our reality. Divine beings, angels, demons, evil spirits, and the such played a role in their experience. It's how they framed their world. It's how they understood life and how they navigated through the different situations that they found themselves in. And for them, there were all these beliefs about the chaos of the sea. Now, for instance, the Babylonians, they believed that before the creation of the world, there was a mighty battle between Tiamat, the sea goddess, a giant sea dragon, and Marduk, the storm god. In the end, Marduk triumphs and slices Tiamat open, takes her carcass, and above is the sky, and takes the carcass below is the sea. This was their creation narrative in very simplistic terms. The Canaanites had a similar story. They believed that Baal fought Yom, and Yom was the sea, and it confined the defeat to the chaos of the sea. These myths, these superstitions were passed down through various cultures. And they talked about the twisting serpent with seven heads, Leviathan, and other monsters of the sea. And what I'm saying is they framed their understanding of the raging waters in these contexts, in these ideas. The sea became a sort of anti-creation for them. It was the place that had not been controlled, the place where everything was raging and mad. But the Israelites, they believed something different. See, they believed that Yahweh created the heavens and the earth. Genesis 1:2, now the earth was formless and empty. Darkness was over the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. And see, rather than a mighty battle among the gods, what do we see? Yahweh speaks, and everything comes into order. Yahweh says the word, and creation obeys. And the seas are parted, the sky above, the sea below. He can rouse the sea so that the land can come back up. At his voice, everything is brought to order. In fact, later we read in the Psalms that it's actually Yahweh who controls the might of the sea. But God is my king from long ago. He brings salvation on the earth. It was he who split open the sea by your power. You broke the heads of the monster in the waters. It was you who crushed the heads of Leviathan and gave it as food to the creatures of the desert. It's Yahweh who commands the chaos. In Psalm 107, some went out to sea in ships. They were merchants on the mighty waters, and they saw the works of Yahweh, his wonderful deeds in the deep. For he spoke. He stirred up a tempest that lifted high the waves, and they mounted up the heavens and went down to the depths. In their peril, their courage melted away. They reeled and staggered like drunkards. They were at their wits' end. But then they cried out to the Lord, to Yahweh, in their trouble. He brought them out of their distress. He stilled the storm to a whisper. The waves of the sea were hushed. They were glad when it grew calm, and he guided them to their desired haven. So let them give thanks to the Lord. Let them give thanks to Yahweh for his unfailing love and his wonderful deeds for mankind. Guys, make no mistake. When Jesus rebuked the wind and the waves in this moment on the Sea of Galilee, his disciples would have been connecting the dots. They would have been putting pieces together in their mind. Yahweh is the one who commands the sea. And yet here Jesus does the exact same thing. Who is this man who is sitting in our boat right now, who commands the chaos of the sea? It would have been blowing their minds that Jesus steps out and does this. Not only that, the ancients believed that the gateway to hell and Hades was right beneath the sea. To them, it was the great abyss. It was a place of evil and torment, and evil spirits would often burst forth from this pit below. When the storms would come, they believed that it was spirits kind of rushing out to cause havoc. So the disciples in this moment, as the storm is raging, as they're terrified, they literally believe all hell is breaking loose. And yet Jesus steps out, and he commands everything to be calm. Who is this guy who has power over this evil place? Who is this man who commands death in Hades and says with a voice, "You have no power here"? Guys, isn't this who we've come to believe? Isn't this who we've come to worship? Jesus, who commands the chaos of our world and brings his peace and his calm and his everlasting life and hope into our madness? Listen, right now, whatever storm you're facing, Jesus has the power and the authority to overcome. Maybe it's financial stress. Like maybe in your life, you're like, you're just looking at the bills and they're piling up and you just can't, you don't know where the end is. Like the debt's piling up, the chain just feels like it's getting tighter. Maybe there's a storm in your marriage right now. Like maybe there's a storm where on the surface everything looks good, but deep down you know that the clouds are rolling in and there's conflict and you're at each other's throats and there's all this turmoil just beneath the surface and there's a storm in that relationship and you don't know what to do. Or maybe it's the kids. The kids always need something and the job is always so demanding and the schedule is go, go, go and you're probably depressed, but who has the time? And the floodwaters just start rushing in all around you and you feel like you're going under. Guys, wherever you find the wind and the waves crashing down in your life right now, I want you to know Jesus is still sovereign over the storm. He is still sovereign over your life. And get this, it was Jesus' idea to get in the boat and go across the sea, right? They were in that storm because it's where Jesus wanted them to be at that moment. Now, whether he knew a storm was coming or that he was just confident they'd be fine either way, that's debatable. But even when we follow the will of the Lord, hard times can come. Madness can sneak up on us. Some storms we create for ourselves, we do that all on our own. Some storms just come. Some storms just happen in our world. And even still, these trials that we face, they can build our faith. In fact, James said to the early church, these trials and testing, it produces in us perseverance. It brings about a greater good for us. But notice also the disciples, they're with Jesus in the storm. He's right there. He hasn't left them. He hasn't forsaken them. He hasn't gone away. And in their panic, in their fear, what do? They cry out to him. Guys, whatever you're facing right now, cry out to Jesus. Do that in your story. Reach out for him because he is right there. Maybe the storm you're in is a chance for you to trust him more. And know this, without the storm, they never would have seen his glory. They never would have known his power. They never would have recognized his authority. And maybe on the other side of your storm that you're walking through right now, you're going to find a testimony. You're going to find something waiting for you. You're going to proclaim to the world that Jesus set me free. That Jesus spoke peace into my madness. He split open the depths of the sea so I could walk through. He made a way. He delivered me. Guys, make no mistake. Jesus will not waste our struggles. And he will receive glory when we look to him. And so the disciples, they go through this crazy storm. They get to the other side. We keep going. Verse 26, it says, they sailed to the region of the Gerasenes, across the lake from Galilee. When Jesus stepped ashore, he was met by a demon-possessed man from the town. And for a long time, this man had not worn clothes or lived in a house, but had lived in the tombs. And when he saw Jesus, he cried out and fell at his feet, shouting at the top of his voice, "What do you want with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I beg you, don't torture me." For Jesus had commanded the impure spirit to come out of this man. And what we learn, it's not just one spirit. Like, there's a whole legion of spirits, demons living within this man, tormenting this guy. And the town is afraid of him. The chains can't control him. He's lost his mind. He spends his days like something out of a horror movie, roaming the tomb, shrieking, growling, groaning, chains rattling. And here he comes running up to the disciples like they just got out of the boat. Imagine the scene. They just get out of the boat. They turn around and here's this guy charging at them, adrenaline-filled, wide-eyed, uncontrollable, out of his mind. This naked madman comes running up to them, unbalanced, convinced that he's been held captive by a whole legion of demons. They're pulling and jerking him in every direction. Like, what do we do in that moment? How do you respond if you're one of Jesus' disciples in this moment? Like, be honest, guys, you're on the ground in the fetal position, right? Like, you just rolled up into a little ball and like the bear's charging at you. If I play dead, he'll leave me alone. Some of you, you're smarter than that. You're sizing up the disciple next to you saying, "Listen, if I trip you and start running, I don't have to be faster than the madman. I just have to be faster than you, okay?" Some of you are looking back at the boat and you're saying, "Listen, I'd rather take my chances on the sea and the storm than stay on the shore anymore." Like, the disciples, they've got to be freaking out. Fear has gripped them in this moment, but not Jesus. Not Jesus, guys. I want you to hear this in your heart if you need it today. Listen, there is nothing in your life that's going to make Jesus want to run from you. There is nothing you have said, nothing you have done, nothing that you have thought, no sin in your life makes Jesus want to turn away. He loves you. He is for you. He's standing on the shore of your life amidst whatever tombs, whatever chains, whatever past story you're bringing to the table, and he's right there just looking you in the eye. He's not running from you. He doesn't run away. There's nothing he can't handle. There's nothing out of bounds. There's nowhere that you can go to escape his authority. There's nowhere you can go that his authority doesn't reach. In fact, think about this, guys. They sailed to the region of the Gerasenes. That's what verse 26 says. It's across the lake from Galilee, across the sea. Now, okay, so crossing the Sea of Galilee, that's one thing. That's bad enough. There's a whole lot of superstition that's around the sea there. But where they went is Gentile territory. This is a pagan land in the minds of the Israelites. They believe wicked spirits roam free. They believe that there was torment in the people. The people were not loyal to the customs and the worship of their God. And so this taps into some of the ancient mindset that scholars call cosmic geography. This idea that Israel, the land of Israel, was meant to be Yahweh's portion. Jacob is mine. Israel is my portion. But outside the borders of the promised land, the ancient Jews believed that dominion had been given to lesser spiritual powers that had become hostile to the God of Israel. Yahweh was the Most High God, El Elyon. But these pagan lands were in rebellion to that reality. This is their worldview as they step out of the boat onto the shore. And yet Jesus has the power and the authority to overcome any situation. Jesus has the power and the authority. And in this moment, Luke is proclaiming that the kingdom of God, it's not bound by geography. More than that, it's advancing with power against the kingdom of darkness. And the demons cry out, verse 28, "What do you want with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I beg you, don't torture me." They know who he is. And they know the authority he commands. They're terrified that Jesus is standing on that shore with them. Guys, do we know who Jesus is? Do we know the authority he commands in this world? Watch what happens as we keep reading to the end of this passage. The demons beg Jesus repeatedly not to order them to go into the abyss. And a large herd of pigs were feeding there on the other side. Demons begged Jesus to let them go into the pigs, and he gave them permission. When the demons came out of the man, they went into the pigs, and the herd rushed down the steep bank into the lake and was drowned. And when those tending the pigs saw what had happened, they ran off and reported this in the town and the countryside. And the people went out to see what had happened. When they came to Jesus, they found the man from whom the demons had gone out sitting at Jesus' feet, dressed in his right mind, and they were afraid. There's that word again. Those who had seen it told the people how the demon-possessed man had been cured. Then all the people of the region of the Gerasenes asked Jesus to leave them because they were overcome with fear. And so he got into the boat and left. And the man from whom the demons had gone out begged to go with him. But Jesus sent him away saying, "Return home. Go tell how much God has done for you." So the man went away and told all over town how much Jesus had done for him. Guys, as we kind of bring this to a close and kind of wrap up today, I want you to see some reactions here. The disciples have this incredible experience. I love how Luke starts it. He says, one day. But you got to imagine, like, looking back, they would have been like, that day. You guys remember that day when all this craziness happened in our life, that day? But among the disciples and the demoniac, the demons and the villagers, they all have the same reaction. Right? There's one commonality to the story. Everyone that experiences the authority of Jesus, the power of Jesus' moment, they're afraid. Right? Each group is afraid. When we come in contact with who Jesus truly is, when we see his glory, when we see his power, we will be afraid. But there's different kinds of fear. In verse 25, the disciples in fear and amazement ask one another, "Who is this guy?" In verse 28, when the demon-possessed man saw Jesus, he falls at his feet. In verse 35, the people went out to see what happened, and when they see the man healed in his right mind, they're afraid. Holy fear grips over them. Verse 37, then all the people of the region of the Gerasene asked Jesus to leave because they're overcome with fear. Everyone in this story is afraid. And this fear across these groups manifests itself in similar but very different ways. Each group comes to Jesus. In their fear, the disciples come to Jesus and say, "Master, don't you care if we drown in this storm?" The demon-possessed man runs to Jesus and throws himself at his feet in fear. The towns come out to see what happens. They come to Jesus to see this man who's done this incredible thing. The man that was set free comes to Jesus begging him to take him with him. Each group comes. Each group begs. Disciples want Jesus to protect them, to guard them. The demons want Jesus to give them a pass, to show leniency. The crowds, the villagers, they beg Jesus just to leave. "We don't want you here." The man begs Jesus, "Let me go with you because you've changed my life. Everything is different now because of you, Jesus." Guys, it brings us down to some questions. Do you fear Jesus? And how? What does that fear look like? So when we stand before his throne, we're going to know that we're not worthy. And the demons, they're afraid of judgment, right? Like, they don't want to go into the abyss. They know the authority he commands. They know who Jesus is. And they don't want to be wiped out. The demons have a fear no one in this room should yet have. They have stood in the presence of God, and yet they chose to rebel. They live now in a time when they know they have been defeated, but they're just waiting for that final decisive blow in the coming day of the Lord. And so they run and they throw themselves down before the Son of the Most High God and they beg him. They beg him for a temporary reprieve from the ultimate horrible ending that awaits for them. And you have to wonder, are we afraid of judgment today? Are you afraid of judgment? Because one day we will all stand before the throne of God, the Most High God. And if you don't love Jesus and accept him as your Lord and Savior, this is the type of fear that you will have in that moment. A fear that looks for a way out. A fear that says, "God, give me a break. Give me a pass." It's not a fear that looks to love him. Are you afraid of judgment? Jesus says, "Fear not." And Jesus says, "There's life in me." And 1 John says, "There is no fear in love, for perfect love drives out fear." Fear has to do with punishment. Jesus would invite you to come. His grace is for you, that you could be wrapped in the righteousness of Christ today, and that when we stand before the throne, God will look at us and see his Son in us. This is the promise that is for those to come and have faith in Jesus. Are you afraid of judgment? The Decapolis villagers, they're afraid to lose their livelihood. Right? They come face to face with the reality of who Jesus is. They look at the pigs that have been destroyed. That was their livelihood. That was their food source, their meal ticket. They look at Jesus and what he did. The man's healed, but their livestock is dead. Jesus cares more about this dude than the livestock that just fell off the cliff. Jesus, you're not good for business. You're not good for my life. You're going to wreck everything. They're not ready to give Jesus control. They're worried about what Jesus might do, what Jesus might change. They're afraid of the change that comes if Jesus stays. And some of you right now, you have opened your heart to the idea that God loves you, that God is for you, that he is the Savior that paid the price for your sin, but you are terrified of what it means to fully surrender your life to Jesus. You're not ready to turn, to hand him the keys and say, Jesus, I'm going to let you drive. You've still got plans, you've still got ideas, you've still got intentions, and if they don't mesh up with where Jesus is going, well, that's going to cause some friction. Some of you are like the villagers right now, and you just want Jesus to stay in his little boat out in the sea. You let me do my thing over here, and I'll come find you when I need you. You're afraid of what Jesus might change. You're afraid of what Jesus might do if you just let him in. So in your fear, you send him away. Are you like the demons who are afraid of judgment? Are you like the villagers who are afraid of change? Guys, are you like the disciples who really just don't know what to think right now? Like their fear has turned to awe and wonder. Like, who is this guy who commands the wind and the waves, who commands evil spirits, and they shriek and they come out of a guy and he's in his right mind? Like, who is this guy? Like, they're starting to get the picture. They're starting to understand. They're starting to see, put the pieces together. They have a holy, reverent fear that Jesus really is the Son of the living God. They're starting to get it. And guys, if you're here this morning and you find yourself seeking Jesus, I pray that you have that kind of fear. One that trembles at Jesus revealing himself and power in your life. But one that marvels at the fact that he loves you. That he is for you. He's taken your sin upon himself. Guys, don't miss the question Jesus asks. He says, where is your faith? What he's asking is, will you trust me? God's calling you. And yes, his power and authority mean much is going to change, but it's an awesome thing to put your faith in Jesus. Are you like the demons afraid of judgment? Are you like the villagers afraid of change? Are you like the disciples that are kind of just in awe and wonder? Or today, are you like that demoniac that was set free? And there's no longer fear in you because you know what God has done for you. You know that he has set you free. God is, maybe the only fear he has is Jesus is getting back in the boat and he's going away and he doesn't know what to do with that. What does God do? What does Jesus do in this moment? He gives him a mission. He says, well, I want you to go back and tell the world what God has done for you. Same mission that Jesus gives to us. I want you to go out into the world and tell them what God has done for you. And so the man, he goes back and he tells the town, he tells the village, he tells everywhere what Jesus has done for him. Who is this man? Jesus, the Son of the Most High God, the one who sets us free. This morning, what does your fear look like? And where is your faith? I pray that you would know the power and authority of Jesus in your life. I pray that you would put your faith in him. Let's pray. So God, help us to trust in you. God, let that be our prayer today, just to trust in you. We don't have all the answers. We don't have all the information, but your word says to look to you, to fix our eyes on you, to put our hope and our faith in you, God. So we're going to do that. Even though the wind and the waves is crashing around us, even though there's turmoil in our hearts, even though There are so many questions and doubts and concerns that are swimming around in our brains, God. We're gonna rise above that today, and we're gonna look to you. We're gonna come to you. We're gonna beg you to move in our story. Because you're the one that has authority, you're the one that has power, you're the one that can change the entire trajectory of our lives, God. We know that you are God. And so we look to you. God, help us to just process where our fear is today. Help us to open our hearts to the change that you would bring. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So guys, I got to tell you, sometimes I have this crazy week, and there are moments where it's wild and hectic, and the storm is crazy, and it's just raging all around me. And what I've learned in some of those moments is to come to the scriptures and just allow God's truth, allow God's promises just to kind of wash over my moments. And when the sea is crazy around me, the waves are pounding hard, I come to this passage in Revelation. Revelation 21, then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away. And there was no longer any sea. For a long time, I didn't realize what that meant. There was no longer any sea, like God was going to take out the ocean in the new plan that he had. But guys, you understand what that really means? Like in the heavenly kingdom that God is bringing, when all is finally set right in the world and everything falls exactly the way he wants it to be, there is no more chaos of the sea. There is no more destructive waves, no more madness, no more rage, no more turmoil. There is no more sea. And what God has in store for those who love him. For behold, I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven, prepared as a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He's going to wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain, for that old order, that chaotic order, the devastation of the sea has passed away. And he who was seated on the throne said, behold, I am making all things new.
Amen.
God is doing a new thing. He's defeated the darkness once and for all, and those who love him, those who put their trust in him, will enjoy the blessings and the promise on that day. Is that you? Have you put your trust in Jesus? Have you surrendered your life to Jesus? Because I'm telling you, you can be made new today. It doesn't start later, it starts now. When we step out in faith and we place our trust in the one who has authority over everything. He's literally holding the universe together. Put your trust in Jesus. Put your hope in Jesus. Make a step. Surrender to his lordship. Be baptized and walk in him. Grow in him. And as you face the storms that come, because we're all going to have those in your struggles, in your trials, know that God is able. And until that day when God sets everything right, he's going to hold us to the storms that we face. We're going to sing a song of response. If you need Jesus, come talk to me. Come learn what it means to surrender your life to him. If you're going through a crazy storm, we're going to have prayer partners at the front of the room. They'd love to pray with you. Let's just trust in this moment that God is God. He's got us. Amen. Let's stand and sing.
I just feel like the Lord put a scripture on my heart and a prayer for you. 2 Timothy 1:7 says that God did not give you a spirit of fear, but of power and love and of sound mind. And if God did not give you fear, who gave you fear? That's the devil. And we can rebuke that. If you feel fear, rebuke it. Stand in your faith. Stand with the confidence that the power that raised Christ is in you, that we have this confidence, that we have this authority. So if you have fear, just stand in agreement with me that we rebuke this. Lord, we rebuke fear in the name of Jesus. You did not give us a spirit of fear, but a power and love and of sound mind. And we embrace your peace, the shalom peace, that Jesus is the King of peace. He's the King of our lives. He's your kingdom come, Lord. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven, God. We cast out fear in the name of Jesus. John 10:10, he came, Jesus said, I came that you would have life and life abundantly. God, bless our church with life, Lord. Abundant life, Lord. Jesus.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea
well, Amen, guys. Hey, I apologize. We've gone a little long today, but that's okay. We've got some graduates to honor. We've got a great set of announcements happening for next week, the picnic and stuff. Guys, immediately after church, community kitchen. If you can help with that, we'd love for you guys to go serve a meal downtown. If you came prepared to give a gift, there are offering boxes on the back walls as you go out the door. Feel free to drop it in there. Guys, God is good.
Yeah.
He is faithful. We're going to go out into the world with trust that he's guiding our steps. We're going to move with God to move people to life. Amen? God bless you guys. Have a great week.